the next batch, they're going to be waiting until you're back, right?
I don't think so.
Well, who's going to...
You, Gustav. You're the chosen one.
I actually wouldn't be terribly surprised if Sid approached one of you guys to ask you guys if you would teach the next batch.
Yes, I would do it. I don't care if I do it wrong, man. It's just more money.
Yeah, that's true. So, he hasn't asked me yet. He might, but... I'm surprised he hasn't asked me yet. Like, oh, so who in the batch do you think is, like, the strongest? Like, who would be better at teaching? Because he did ask me that about Mahbub and Jeevan, actually.
Really?
Around the time that it was time for them to graduate, he was like, oh, do you think either one of them could be, like, an SME? And I was like, no, not really. I was like, please don't do that to me. Because I was like, honestly, like... neither one of them really knows, and they would just come to me for everything. So, it's like you give me 8 consultants to train, and you give them 8 consultants to train, and I would essentially just have 16 consultants to train, because they would just come to me for everything. So,
yeah.
I was like, don't do that to me. To say here, deep neural networks for regression. So the only difference between regression and classification, right, is you can have all the hidden layers and all that kind of stuff you want, and then all that's going to happen is at the end. So basically, from the input layer all the way up to your last hidden layer. There's really nothing that differentiates a regression network from a classification network, right? They look exactly the same. The only thing that happens that's different is at the end, if you're just doing like a, you know, if you're predicting a single y, or, you know, a y that's just a real number, then you just have one node at your output. If you're in the situation where you're predicting a vector-valued y, then you have k nodes at your output. But the only difference here is that you just don't have an activation function. So it's like you have this whole network that has all these nonlinearities, all these nonlinear activation functions, and layers and layers and layers of weights that can introduce all kinds of complexity and ability to conform to nonlinear hypotheses. And then at the end, it all just kind of comes out this fire hose right at the end that's just linear regression. So... yeah, that's effectively it. That's really it. The activation functions that we use or that we apply to layers in networks for classification, like sigmoid and softmax and hyperbolic tangent, all of these activation functions serve to restrict the outputs of that layer to be between a certain, you know, there to be within a certain range of numbers, right? So for sigmoid and softmax, everything ends up being between 0 and 1. And for hyperbolic tangent, everything ends up being between negative 1 and 1. And so you can't really, you know, fit these networks to regression tasks because your network can only produce numbers within a certain range, right? But if you remove that, if you get rid of that activation function, then now... the output of your network can be the output of this linear combination, right, that you would apply an activation function to, but that could be anything. That could be any order. So now your model actually is able to approximate functions and approximate real numbered targets in this way. So, sorry if that's a little disappointing. It's really that simple. So the only thing that we're going to do that's different here is instead of using our cross-entropy objective function, because we are doing regression, we're back to our ordinary least squares objective function. Okay, that's it. So let's go ahead and just look at what the gradient looks like here. So now, before, where we were applying an activation, right, we had like a gradient with respect to z, in this case it would be zl of j, and we had a gradient with respect to hl of j. In this case, we're not applying an activation function, right? Or if we want to say that we are, our activation function is just the identity function. So now there's really no difference between the gradient with respect to ZL and the gradient with respect to HL. Okay? Both of these are just the linear combination that goes into this layer, so both of these, ZL and HL, are just y hat. Okay, so let's remember that our gradient with respect to, I'm going to, again, just for simplification, get rid of the 1 over n, keeps our gradient simpler. So before, we had that our gradient with respect to h at the hidden, or at the last layer, the output layer, for a classification network was p hat minus y, right? So just kind of for comparison. So let's take the gradient of this thing with respect to y hat. So we're going to get, if we kind of expand this out and we use our vectorized representation of this, then we get, oops, that's a weird looking line. Maybe I ain't more either. These are vectors. So we get y transpose y minus 2. Y transpose y hat plus y hat transpose y hat. Okay? So we've extended that out. So now we differentiate this thing with respect to y hat. We get no derivative with respect to y hat there.
Yep.
We get a derivative of negative 2y transpose as our gradient there, or derivative there. And then we have a vector being multiplied by itself, right? Dot product by itself. So we get a 2, and we get a y hat transpose. Okay, so our 2's all cancel out here, and we end up with, oh, this is our derivative, sorry, I shouldn't have written J. This is our derivative of J with respect to y hat. right, so then we're going to end up with y hat transpose minus y transpose, but then we don't really want this to be in terms of y hat transpose, we want this to be in terms of y hat, so we can just take the transpose of it. This is fine because we aren't really changing any of the y hat values, right? We're just changing it from a row vector to a column vector. So we just take the transpose of this, we end up with y hat minus y. So again, this ends up being, this y hat is like the linear combination that goes into that output layer, right? The same thing that we've been calling H for classification, right? So we've actually just gone ahead and shown that our gradient with respect to H at the output layer of J or a regression network instead of P hat minus Y is Y hat minus Y. Right?
But that's only for multiple linear, it wouldn't be for multivariate, right?
I mean, we can go ahead and do it if you want, right? So it would just be, you know, if you guys actually remember the proof, we had y and y hat that were matrices, but it all still actually shakes out to be the same thing, right? Like, we actually still ended up with the same gradient and all that kind of stuff, so we would still end up with y hat minus y. They would just both be matrices in the general case where we're doing a multivariate
Jeremy,
regression. Yes?
In the last one, in the parentheses, what is it?
The last
H
L.
L.
Right here?
No, the last one.
H L.
Is H sub H
yeah.
L. H L. Superscript L in parentheses. Indicating this is of the alpha layer. So, if we do the thing where we have matrix, then if you remember, we have to do the Frobenius norm, we have to use this like trace thing, but it ends up coming out to the same thing. So we can see if I can remember the alternate definition well enough. So we would get that J equals right, so it's that. Let's see, but yeah, this ends up being equal to, via the alternate definition of the Frobenius norm, this ends up being the trace y hat transpose times y minus y hat, right? And then this is equal to 1/2 times the trace of y transpose y minus 2 y transpose y hat plus y hat transpose y hat. We'd go to take the derivative. Remember, the trace actually doesn't affect the derivative at all. So, right, like it's almost exactly the same proof. So we'd end up with negative 2 y transpose plus 2 y hat transpose, and then, yeah, we pretty much get the exact same place from here. Just cancel out. This ends up being equal to transpose, or sorry, y hat transpose minus y transpose, but then we don't want this to be in terms of the transpose, we want this to be in terms of y. So again, we're not changing what any of the weights are, we're just changing whether we're looking at things row-wise or column-wise, so we can go ahead and just take the transpose to get our gradient, and we'd get y hat minus y. So for the more general case, this is how it works out. Yes?
So I had this question before, which I forgot about. So like, why don't we just take the derivative of j function straight away without like deriving the full square mod? A little bit just easier, like the two goes like before, like if you look just at the loss function, if we take the derivative with respect to j y hat, two just goes before and
No, because what ends up happening, because of like all these different operations that happen in here that are kind of implied, you end up with y hat minus y, whereas if I think if you did what you're thinking, you'd end up with y minus y.
No, actually, like, it's basically a complex function, because you have to, you then have to multiply by the derivative of the inner function, which would be minus 1, so you...
Oh yeah, you're right. Yep. So, it's another thing. Another thing you can do. Again, assuming
like
that you're, well, so you would end up with, so the outer function, which is something squared, right, 1/2 times something squared, and then you take the derivative of this inner function, but then this inner function is kind of more complex because it's the Frobenius norm of this difference, it's not just this difference, right? So we're just kind of simplifying it because I don't know off the top of my head some formula for like the derivative of the Frobenius norm of some matrix, right? So instead we just kind of simplify it by expanding it out according to the definition of what the Frobenius norm is, and then we take the derivative. So yeah, I mean, there's probably some table somewhere where you can just look up, like, you know, what's the you know, what's the derivative with respect to x of, like, you know,
like it turns out to be the same as the derivative for like just x.
Does it?
Well, I mean, looks like.
Not exactly. That's the thing. It's not clear that that's true.
Well, it's not clear, but it turns out. But like, if we have the previous one where we have just the vectors, the sum of vectors, or the sum of different y's. Do we do that as well? Like, would it be more like...
you mean doing like the derivative element-wise?
Yeah.
You certainly can. It's a mess. It takes a long time. And you have to bear in mind that actually, the reason why I don't do it that way is because you're kind of manipulating a single equation, but you actually have to bear in mind that you have d different equations that look like the equation you're manipulating. And so you have to remember that the whole thing that you're manipulating is actually a system of D equations instead of just the one equation. But we don't even know what D is, right? Like, so it's hard to actually, like, really write it down. You just have to kind of, like, say, like, oh, well, you know, bear in mind there are actually, like, D minus 1 other equations that look just like this one that we're manipulating. And it's really hard to kind of bring it all together. Well, it's not really hard, but it's just less clear, like, how you can bring it all together and how it turns into this matrix operation without just doing the matrix operation. And ultimately, even if you try and derive, you know, the gradient doing element-wise stuff, you have to arrive at a matrix, you know, at a fully vectorized solution, right? Because that's, like, the only efficient way to do this. So... Yeah, I can see. So first of all, you would have to look up something, right? Some table or whatever, some proof that like verifies for you that this is the case, right? Which I don't know for sure. If you found some table that tells you that, then great. So I don't know that this is true in general. It appears that it might actually work in this case, but I'm not totally sure that works in general.
Yeah, but like in this case, it should work.
Because we got the same. Just lifeline, like.
More yeah, you would get the same thing. So you'd get, you take the two up front, right? The one half and the two cancel. We just then have the Frobenius norm of y minus y hat. We take the derivative of that with respect to y hat. So that means we have to just take the derivative of this thing, this Frobenius norm thing, which would just get us then y minus y hat. And then we would have to take the derivative of that inner function with respect to y hat, which would be negative 1, which would flip the way that things, that these things are. So if that is correct, that in general this is true, then yeah.
Well,
it just may work out that way in this case.
Shouldn't be correct. I mean, I don't see a reason why.
I don't see a reason why it wouldn't be either, but I would need to see some proof that shows that it works in general and not just in this one case. So.
Like, if we wouldn't have a matrix, like, a real number, we could just do that without any, proof, like, without any hesitation.
Yeah. You'll have to look that up and see what the derivative of the Frobenius norm of a matrix is. Yeah, you're right. That would be much simpler if that just, or a much simpler way to do it if that just worked in general. Although there would be a lot more of just like, just trust me, it works, right?
Yeah.
The derivative of a Frobenius norm of x is just x, right? So like, fuck you guys, stop. Right? So eventually, you know, I'll just keep cutting out more and more steps, and eventually my proof will just look like this. That's why. Like, there. Proved
it. You're doing it with this finger?
He's missing one.
Oh, yeah, you're right. I am doing it backwards. So, my thumb's over here, right? When I'm doing machine learning. But, yeah, you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Alright, so we see then that we start out in exactly the same way, right? That our gradient with respect to what we could call HL is
y hat minus y.
Y hat minus y.
Yep.
Okay, so now let's take our gradient with respect to our weights, and this actually should look incredibly familiar. We've already done this, so we'll start here again, removing the 1 over n just to keep the gradients simpler. Right, we'll kind of just keep on the same track. Doing this in general. Right. So now we want to take the derivative here with respect to our weights at this layer. So we're going to go ahead and expand this guy out in our usual way. So this is going to end up being the trace of y hat, or y minus y hat transpose with itself. This then expands out into our usual thing of y transpose y minus 2. Y transpose y hat plus y hat transpose y hat. Okay? Now, though, we're going to go ahead and substitute in what y hat is. So we're going to get y hat transpose, or sorry, y transpose y minus 2. y transpose, and now y hat is going to be our hidden layer, right, our last hidden layer. Times our weight matrix. Right? And then plus, I'm gonna have to write this on the next line because we're out of room. So plus, now we're gonna have this thing transposed, right? Which is gonna be WL transpose Z L minus 1 transpose times Z L minus 1 times W L. Right? That's what the scale looks like now. So now we're going to take the derivative of this thing with respect to W L. Right? Because that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to take the derivative with respect to our weights. So we get no derivative there. Derivative here is negative 2 y transpose z L minus 1, and then plus 2 times WL transpose Z L minus 1 transpose times Z L minus 1. Okay? All of our 2's cancel out, as always. Okay. Now we can rearrange. Well, again, we don't want this to be in terms of W transpose. We want it in terms of W, so we can, also, before we do that, let's go ahead and move this guy together. No, that's not true. We don't want to do that. Nothing's equal to zero. Sorry, nothing about the other thing over here. So let's go ahead and just take the transpose of everything. Right, so this is going to end up being equal to...
Is that Z subscript L minus D?
L minus 1.
Minus 1, okay.
So we're going to get this guy transpose times the transpose of this thing, but that's just Z L minus 1, and then our weight matrix WL minus this guy, this Z L minus 1 transpose times Y and I think you guys can see where we're going next, because this is exactly like the proof before. We can actually factor out this Z L minus 1 transpose, and then we're left with that multiplied by this minus Y. This is Y hat, and so we get Z L minus 1 transpose times y hat minus y, which is equal to Z L minus 1 transpose times our gradient with respect to HL. Right, so this looks exactly like we expect. This is all still following
Can I go to the toilet?
Sure. Okay,
you guys
all good?
Just a second. Go. Thank you.
So we've got the exact same readiness for the weights, right?
Everywhere is the same.
Sure.
Sorry, what?
We got the exact same readiness for the weights.
Yep. So this looks exactly the same too. So
it would be exactly the same because we kind of do one less derivative. I guess that depends on the because we plug in the previous one.
Yep.
The HL, that would be different.
Yep. But we actually found that at this output layer, before it was E hat minus Y, now it's Y hat minus Y.
Mm-hmm.
So it still looks the same.
Okay. Also, Z. Z would be different. The latest part of the gradient. So we actually don't do
the activation.
The activation, yeah.
So if you just make it so that that's the identity,
so
right, you can just consider it to be the identity, then this just becomes 1, and so then this just becomes this times 1.
So then
1.
It becomes like versus the classification, R of Z becomes 1.
Yeah, at the output layer.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Like in the gradient, whole gradient.
So there will be other activations of other hidden layers, and this holds true.
Alright, so this is just for the output.
Yeah, so we did it specifically for the output layer to show that like this this starts out exactly the same way. Okay. Alright. So there you guys are ready. You guys are all good? Okay. So now we found that our gradient with respect to W, this output layer, is equal to just as we expected. So the next thing down, right, the next layer back, or the next step back through our network, would be to find the gradient with respect to our last hidden layer. Okay? Hold on a minute, so I erased all that stuff now, dang. Because we're going to do kind of the same thing. There we are again.
This time we have taken the derivative with respect to...
With respect to ZL1. Or ZL minus 1, sorry. Right, so with respect to the hidden layer, it's just before the output. Alright, so expanding this guy out. making our substitutions. Try and make these a little bit smaller. Pretty sure, trying to remember my formulas here for matrix calculus. Go like this. Nothing there. There, plus 2, I'm not pretty sure we get, transpose, Z minus 1 transpose. Alright, our 2's cancel out. We see that this is actually equal to y hat transpose right here. So then we would get y hat transpose W L minus Y transpose WL. Oops, let me get the parentheses there. Okay, we can go ahead and take the transpose of everything because we, that's what we've been doing all this time. So this is going to give us. No, actually, we're gonna. Let's see. Let's make absolutely sure. This is even defined now. Yeah, I think I have to go back and make sure that I remember what my formulas are. actually what we end up with when we apply our derivative formulas for differentiating with respect to z. So then our 2's cancel out. Our w's can get factored out, or w transpose, and then we have just recognized that this is equal to, we transpose everything, this switches the order as well. Right, we recognize that this is y hat, and so we end up with y hat minus y times this ends up being exactly what we thought. So this is our gradient with respect to h times our weights. So after this, we actually just end up going back once we, so these are actually all the variables that we have access to directly, right? So then beyond this, we're actually just going to keep doing what we did before now, where we use the chain rule. So all of our gradients are going to look just like they do, but we're just going to have to keep multiplying things by more and more derivatives as we go further and further down because of the chain rule. And everything else, our activations and everything, are going to look identical to how they would look for classification. And so it's just going to continue to look exactly the way that it looked for classification, right? So this shows that everything actually looks the same at our output layer, which is the only thing that we've changed. Everything else stays the same. So let's see. Do we have enough time to train the regression network now?
Do you want to do a break now and to come?
Oh wait, that's right.
One
so 15. I have to facilitate an interview for Mabu at 2:00. Not two. Yeah, at 2:00. So it would be silly for us to go to lunch at 12:30 and then come back at 1:30 and have class for half an hour and then have me go. So we're actually just gonna have lunch at 1:00. Is everybody cool with that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So that means we actually have like 40 minutes, which is great. So,
and we finish after.
I think so.
Function.
So, let's go ahead and do a deep neural network for regression, where all we've changed is that it's for regression. I'm not even going to change what the hidden layers look like. Okay? Then we'll talk about another activation function that's commonly used in regression. Oh, it's right there. In regression, and it's also actually quite good for computer vision problems, called the rectified linear unit. We'll kind of talk about some benefits of it, but also some problems. And we'll show you how it actually looks in code. And then we'll fit a fit a deep network using this rectified linear unit activation function. Or maybe I might just send you guys code that does that, because if I'm going to have to train the thing for like a million iterations, we're going to actually spend a lot of time in class just waiting for it to run. Because so. It really does, it, at least on this computer, it takes a good like 10, 15 minutes just for the code to run. So.
So I don't get it, Jeremy. Why would it look exactly the same for the activation functions if we're not using activation functions for regression?
It's just because in the end, these things are all just logistic regression, which in the end actually still just uses linear regression. So you remember this, I mean, it shouldn't really be a huge surprise, because when we were doing linear regression and logistic regression, our gradients actually looked identical for those as well, if you remember, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's just that anywhere that we were doing regression, we had y-hat for our output, and anywhere that we were doing classification, we had p-hat.
Mm-hmm.
For our output, but otherwise the formulas were exactly the same. It was just the only difference was If you were doing regression, it was y hat. If you were doing classification, it was b hat. So, I don't know. It doesn't even seem like a real shock because, like, from the beginning, these gradients have looked the same.